I'm Jim Turner, and welcome to dLife TV Online. It's going to be a great show in a new place. We'll be here Sundays at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, with new shows about living your dLife. Every week, we'll be sharing insights, recipes from the dLife kitchen, stories about real people living and achieving with diabetes, and so much more. We're glad you're here. Now on with the show. For the slopes, make sure you got everything you need. And if you're heading for the slopes and you have diabetes, you better watch this.
Okay, so now we're slowly gonna turn so we're all facing uphill. Good tail side, good toe side. Riding on insulin is a program for children, teens, and young adults with type 1 and type 2 diabetes to understand and learn about their diabetes in this winter environment where altitude and a cold climate plays a role in their diabetes.
Let's all check, okay? Go ahead and squeeze that.
What was his last reading?
333.
So he is coming down there, okay.
111.
Good job, buddy. That's exactly where we want it.
I'm ready to go snowboard.
As a winter athlete living with diabetes, Sean knows firsthand the difficulty of maintaining good control while hitting the slopes. In 2004, Sean was competing on the professional snowboarding circuit when he was plagued by bouts of nausea and chronic sickness. After 8 visits to the hospital and losing over 30 pounds, Sean pondered an early retirement from the sport.
I was diagnosed at the age of 19. I was actually misdiagnosed due to my age. I was told I had type 2 diabetes. Went about 3 months without insulin. I was finally given the correct diagnosis on my mother's birthday of type 1 diabetes, and that first shot of insulin was the most amazing experience after going so long just feeling like I was wasting away. I'm still learning about managing my diabetes in this sort of environment, but as I was learning how, I didn't have a set guidebook to follow. I didn't know of any other snowboarders at a competitive level or professional level that had diabetes. So everything that I learned was through trial and error, and I tested my blood sugars constantly, saw what food did to my blood sugars and how I managed it with activity as well as my insulin levels. During the time that I was going through all this trouble, I came across the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation. And so I was able to read on their website stories of these 2-year-olds, 5-year-olds, 16-year-olds that have juvenile diabetes and how they live with it daily.
Sean created the Writing on Insulin Camp as a way to give something back to those who inspired him to continue pursuing his passion.
Tomorrow we will be getting on a charter bus and going on the windy road to Snow Summit. What we'll do when we get there is we'll discuss diabetes and some ways of keeping your blood glucose meter warm, as well as keeping your insulin from freezing. I don't think that'll be too much of a case tomorrow, but for any other times that you guys may be in a cold environment, there'll be some good tips.
This is my first time doing riding on insulin. I'm very excited to meet new people and meet Sean and go snowboarding with him and learn more about the diabetes and snowboarding.
What does your doctor like you to be around usually?
About 100.
Yeah. Do you play any other sports?
I play soccer and softball.
And does he still want your sugars around there
yeah.
or any higher or so?
Just about that.
Okay. Do you check him pretty often?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. Today I would say it's probably in the high 40s, low 50s. So. Just gotta stay hydrated and make sure that the sugars are running in check. So go ahead and take out your meters and we'll all check. Oh, know before you go. Know as you right before you get on that chairlift. You don't want to have a low blood sugar on the chairlift. It can be scary. If you doubt, just check. It just takes a few seconds of your time.
In addition to frequent blood glucose testing, Sean encourages everyone to come to the mountain fully prepared.
When doing any winter sports, you want to bring your test strips, your meter, some extra lancets. If you're on the pump, bring extra infusion sets, extra insulin in case it goes bad, batteries for your pump, because you know cold weather can drop the battery life, some form of glucose. The key is being prepared so you can, if anything happens, you can counter whatever happens and just be ready to take it on.
This is great right here, dude.
The board I have that I compete on is very special to me. At every camp, I bring it around and have the participants sign it. It was because of these participants that inspired me to continue my snowboarding career. So when I'm in that start gate, I want to be able to look down at my board and see the names of all of the participants that have been the riding on this, and all the kids, these teenagers, these young adults that live with this disease. So when I'm in that start gate, I can look down, be inspired by them, and know who I'm racing for.
Armed with the knowledge of how cold, humidity, and altitude affect his diabetes, Sean continues riding on insulin towards the 2014 Winter Olympics in Russia. Until then,
I hope that participants will walk away with new friends, new support, and the basic understanding of how their body acts in this winter environment.
I'm going to definitely continue riding on insulin, and I'm totally going to come back next year and do the same thing.
Buddy, good job today.
Ooh, something smells good. I wonder what Chef Michelle Nishan is whipping up in the dLife kitchen today.
Hi, and welcome to dLife Kitchen. I'm Michelle Nishan, and today we're going to cook a healthy, hearty, low-carb chili. Now, what I dig about this recipe is that it's low in carbs, but really high in protein. And whether you're living with diabetes or not, increasing your protein intake and decreasing carbohydrates is a great way to control blood sugar and watch your weight. Now let's get started. Here I have some grapeseed oil in a misto, and I've preheated a pan over a medium fire just so everything's gonna cook evenly. Now, the things that give chili its best flavor are onions, peppers, garlic, mushrooms, vegetables, any vegetable you like, really. But what we want to start with is just kind of sweating the vegetables in a saute pan, just about a minute or so. Now, the next step is to add the ground beef. Now, we've chosen a lean ground beef because it's lower in fat. What you want is something with about maybe 20% fat. Now we've got the meat nicely browned, what we're going to do is that good old trick of pouring some of the liquid off that contains most of the remaining fat. Now, we don't want to drain everything. Just by removing about 2/3 of the juice, we've probably removed now up to 90% of the fat between the choice that we made in the ground beef and just removing that little bit of liquid. We want to leave some of those juices in there because they are tasty. Now we're going to add some quartered mushrooms, and these can be fresh or canned and drained. The next step is adding some of these amazing spices. Here we have some cumin, and cumin is a great spice. A lot of these spices come with a variety of health benefits. Cumin is high in iron, really good stuff. We have some cinnamon. Here we have some red pepper flakes, some really amazing allspice, and of course, what's chili without chili powder? Gonna stir these in, let them toast a little bit in the pan, coat the meat really nicely. Now this is really starting to smell chili-esque, so to speak. A little bit of black pepper, a little bit of sea salt, and we're gonna add a couple of bay leaves, and these bay leaves are amazing because what they do is they kind of add this richer, deeper flavor to the chili. Now we're gonna take some tomato paste, we're gonna stir the paste into the meat, and then we're gonna add some water. And there you have it. You have the base for a really good chili. We're gonna stir this, let it come back to a simmer, and then we're gonna cover and cook it for about 3 hours so all these flavors can develop. Some of the water can evaporate off. You're gonna have this nice, rich chili with a great base sauce. All right, 3 hours later, look at that. Wow, smells just amazing. So Here you have this amazing low-carb, high-protein chili, perfect to serve hot or to freeze it and save it for a rainy day. What I like to do is just ladle it into a bowl, just like this. And then here we have a little bit of no-fat yogurt, some green onions or scallions. I like to stir it in and then just do a little bit of a dollop on top. And when I cut the onions, I love to save the ends because then you can just do really attractive little garnish like that. So there's your high-protein, low-carb chili. For this recipe and many more like it, come visit us at dlife.com/recipebox. Thanks for joining us in the dLife Kitchen. I'm Michelle Michon. See you next time.
A few years ago, I was at a charity golf tournament in Seattle, and there was a guy with a red headband on that said Eric the Red, and he was testing his blood sugar, and I started talking to him, and the Eric the Red part was he was a competitive eater, and he has type 1 diabetes. I was fascinated that someone could be a competitive eater and have type 1 diabetes.
Morning. Welcome.
He's down here in San Diego for a flauta eating contest. We're gonna find out what he does to prepare and how he lives his life as a competitive eater. And by the way, don't do this at home.
How'd you get involved with competitive eating?
I guess it started when I was in college, actually. I would try and find like the hottest hot sauce I could find and see if I could handle it, you know? And my friends, you know, would always challenge me and they would try too and then, you know, they'd be devastated. So I was like, well, I can do it. You know, I'm not gonna be devastated by it.
So how does your diabetes affect you before a competition and afterwards?
It's just another factor. I mean, everyone's going through a lot before a competition, honestly. I just test my blood sugar. It definitely cannot be high, you know, going into a contest, but I like to keep it below 70 just before a contest.
I'm 56. Perfect.
On the day of a contest, I hardly ever eat anything. So it's a pretty simple formula of how much insulin to take to know my blood sugar is gonna come down. Because I got basically nothing in me to, you know, keep my blood sugar up, so.
So in this particular competition, where do you want your blood sugar levels to be, like at breakfast, lunch, and then just prior to it?
I'm gonna take a lot of insulin before the contest, right before the contest, you know, and so it's gonna be a little bit of a timing issue because I've gotta know when the contest is gonna start. And I've got to take it before it's going to really start to kick in. Then after the contest, definitely I'll need to continue to take shots probably every hour, you know, take shots of Humalog, fast-acting insulin, and then I'll monitor my blood sugar real closely.
What do your doctors say about being a competitive eater?
I mean, my doctor's been great. He's been, you know, supportive, and he just says, as long as your A1Cs are good and it doesn't affect you and, you know, you're healthy. Diabetes, everything is about sort of making compromises with your body and with your lifestyle. And as long as you can find a balance in your life, then you can do anything.
So you've never thought it like this is a crazy thing to do? Or have you?
Oh, of course. I mean, yeah, that's what's appealing to me, yeah. It is out of the norm, yeah.
Looks like he's on 25.
I think that's one of the main things that really appeals to me because You get to see just a different side of, you know, culture and people and life in general. I mean, you know, it's a bizarre sort of social study. It's just interesting. I'm totally interested in competitive eating. Even if I wasn't a competitor, I'd still be totally fascinated by it.
Well, it's very admirable. You're in great shape and you don't take this lightly.
It's fun. It's not always serious, but you know, to be good at it, you do have to be very serious about it. And as far as like my health goes, my diabetes, always very serious about it. I'm passionate about it. You know, I don't take diabetes for granted. And I also don't shame myself or other people with diabetes.
Having talked to you now, I'm totally impressed. I really am.
Well, I hope to do well. I hope to represent all diabetics tomorrow. That when I'm putting down my 70th flauta, I hope that it's in victory. Mm-hmm.
My name is Kim. I'm 17 years old, and I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes 6 years ago.
Hi, Hannah.
Hello.
Hi.
It's good to see you. Come on in.
SafeSittings is a service where teenagers with diabetes babysit for kids with diabetes. I came up with the idea of safe sittings because a lot of families who have children with diabetes are desperate to find a babysitter who has the knowledge to take care of their child. I met with my school nurse who got me in touch with the nurses in the area. We all had a meeting and they told different families with kids and who have diabetes in their schools. And then parents told parents and it sort of grew like that. When all of the babysitters get together who live in my area, we sort of form a support group for each other.
I think the thing for me that really drives me crazy is being in school and like taking a test and you know your blood sugar is high, so, and you can't just all of a sudden be like, sorry, my blood sugar is like out of control, I can't take the test anymore. But when your blood sugar is high, you can't concentrate as much.
Sometimes you do all the right things and you take your insulin, but your blood sugar is just high for no reason, and
it's frustrating.
It's really frustrating and not being in control of your own health all the time.
It's really nice because we all have friends and everyone, but no one really knows what it's like to have diabetes unless you have it.
When I was first diagnosed and I would have an issue, no one else, you know, as much as your friends try and help you, they don't really understand. And it's nice to hear some people who have gone through the similar issues.
Once I got all these responses, I came up with the idea to create a website where babysitters can post their profile and where they live, and then families can also post a profile saying they need a babysitter, and then the babysitters and the families can contact each other.
No, it'll be something very positive to do.
So she's eaten dinner, and she's done with dinner, and her numbers have been pretty good today. She hasn't been too high or too low. I told her she could have dessert. She wanted to wait till you got here.
I don't think we went out at the beginning for a long time.
In the first few months, the only time we were apart for more than a few hours was if Hannah was with her grandparents.
I feel like Kim's babysitting service has really provided us with just a peace of mind. It's just an amazing thing as a parent to feel that, you know, your child is safe.
I think it's cool because my babysitter has diabetes, so I can ask her questions that nobody else can.
Someone watched me test and then they told the whole grade and it got me really upset. It was sort of annoying that every 62 kids knew.
One of the other great things that Kim brings to Hannah is the perspective of somebody else who's had diabetes at school. Being teased, having to leave the classroom a lot, some important lessons that Hannah can learn from her.
The end. I like that book.
True.
So your blood sugar was good. We just tested before we started reading. So it's bedtime.
Mm-hmm.
Good night.
Good night, Kelly Lily.
Good night, Hannah Banana. See you soon.
That's the show for today. Thanks for tuning in. I know I learned a lot, and I want to know what you think. So be sure to share your thoughts in the comments below, and I'll see you here next Sunday, 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, for another exciting episode of dLife TV Online.